Good morning, students. Welcome back to this video session. So, in this video lecture, we shall discuss on basic concepts on design of pavement. Okay. So, anyway, here in this subject in highway engineering, in sixth semester, so we will not be discussing in detail about the pavement design because for your syllabus only. Determination of equivalent single wheel load by graphical method is there. So remaining part of the pavement design will be discussed in the higher semester in the subject pavement design. Okay, so here, so whatever the things that are there in your syllabus, we shall cover only so much. Okay, so now pavement. So pavement is the durable material laid down on an area intended to sustain vehicular load or foot traffic such as road or a walkway. So in other words, the pavement, you can consider it as a component of the roadway system, so which is laid over an area intended to sustain a vehicular load or foot traffic. Here the question is, why do we need this pavement? Okay, so usually when the vehicles are allowed to travel on the roadway, there will be n number of stresses developed. Okay, so these stresses, these loads needs to be spread over a larger area. Okay, distributed over a larger area, because if you consider directly allowing the vehicles directly on the soil or earth pavements. Okay, so earth, the soil or earth does not have so much capacities to sustain those kind of loads. Okay, so for that reason, so we are adding this component called pavement in order to distribute this load over a larger area, so that when the stresses reaches this soil or subgrade, the stresses will be minimum because it is being distributed over a larger area. So that is nothing but a pavement. Okay, so here usually as far as pavement is concerned, so I have got two types of pavement. One is flexible pavement or bituminous pavement, or you can call it as a blacktop pavement. So then second one is rigid pavement or cement concrete pavement or white top pavement. So we shall see what exactly they are or what is the difference between flexible and rigid pavement. Flexible pavement usually have low flexural strength. Okay, so the name itself indicate the flexible pavement or this bituminous pavement is a flexible one. So usually you might have seen this tar roads. Okay, so or bituminous roads, so the top layer is flexible. Okay, so that means it does not provide any resistance to bending. So if you apply a load, it will bend or deflect. So when the load is removed, and it will regain its original position. So that is what you call it as a flexible. So hence the flexible pavement is having low or no flexural strength. Whereas a rigid pavement, nothing but a concrete pavement, it have certain high flexural strength compared to flexible pavements. So then load is transferred by grain to grain contact. So here you can see, yeah, so the type of loading is in flexible pavement, it is grain to grain transfer. It actually takes in a rectangular portion. So but in case of rigid pavement, the type of load transfer is in the form of slab action. So for example, if it is a rigid pavement, so if you apply a load, this entire load is being applied over this area because this pavement is a rigid one. Okay, so now if it is a flexible pavement, so where number of aggregates will be there, number of layers will be there below this. So when you apply a load, so if this is one aggregate, okay, so now this load is being transferred to the aggregates below that. Okay, so now that load is being transferred to the aggregates below that. So grain to grain transfer will takes place in case of flexible pavement. Then the third difference is the surfacing cannot be laid directly over the subgrade, but a base course or sub base course is needed. So here in case of flexible pavement, the surface course cannot be laid directly over the subgrade. Okay, so but in case of rigid pavement, so you can directly lay the surface course on the subgrade or with the help of one more layer called base course. Then no thermal stresses are induced, but in case of rigid pavement, thermal stresses are induced. Then expansion joints are not needed. Usually joints will not be there in case of flexible pavement. Here number of joints will be there in rigid pavement, such as expansion joint, contraction joints, longitudinal joints, transverse joints, like that joints will be there. So here the design life of the flexible pavement is between 10 to 15 years. In case of rigid pavement, the design life might be 30 to 40 years. Sorry, I have written 20 to 30, so it has to be 30 to 40 years. Initial cost of construction is low in case of flexible pavement, but initial cost of construction is very high in rigid pavement. So maintenance cost is high in case of flexible pavement, but maintenance cost is very low in case of rigid pavement. But when you but when you consider this life cycle cost, okay, life cycle cost in that that means including initial cost, maintenance cost, even vehicle operation cost. So when you consider a life cycle cost, the rigid pavement will have a low life cycle cost compared to a flexible pavement. Then road can be used for the traffic within 24 hours of the construction. So in case of flexible pavement, the road may be allowed to be used by the road users, so within 24 hours or within a day after construction. So but here so here the road cannot be used at least for a period of 14 days of curing. So lot of curing is required in case of rigid pavement. As you already know, it is made of concrete. So then in case of flexible pavement, it is damaged by oils and certain chemicals. So no such thing occurs in case of rigid pavement. So that is the major differences between flexible pavement and rigid pavement. So here you can see rigid pavement or concrete pavement. This is a flexible pavement or black topped pavement, or even you can call it as a bituminous or asphalt pavement. So both in one picture you can see a flexible pavement and a rigid pavement. So the requirements of the pavement. So here the pavement should have sufficient thickness to distribute the wheel load stresses to safe value on the subgrade soil. So here whether it is a bituminous pavement or whether it is a concrete pavement, so the main intention is to protect the subgrade or lower layers. So for that reason, the pavement should have sufficient thickness to distribute this wheel load stresses to a safe value, right? So as far as possible, when these stresses reaches the subgrade, it should be as less as possible. Okay, so that means the load needs to be distributed over a larger area of subgrade. Okay, so that can be done by providing a higher thickness pavement. So then the second one is the pavement should be structurally strong to withstand all types of stresses imposed upon it. So that means whatever the type of stresses, it may be the stress due to vehicular loading, the stress due to environmental changes, so all these kind of stresses needs to be withstood by the pavement. So then adequate coefficient of friction to prevent skidding of the vehicles. So the pavement should neither be too smooth nor it should be too rough. If it is very smooth, what happens? So if the pavement is totally frictionless, so in such cases skidding, slipping is likely to happen. So if the pavement is very rough, in that case skidding might happen. So therefore it is very important for a pavement to have adequate coefficient of friction to prevent either slipping or even skidding. And then the smooth surface to provide comfort to the road users at even higher speed. The surface should be smooth enough. That means the riding quality of the pavement should be very good. So then it should produce least noise from the moving vehicles. What happens if the undulations are there on the pavement? So due to this undulations, there is a possibility that due to vehicle parts, unpleasant noise will be formed. So that means it should be smooth such that it should produce least noise from the moving vehicles. The pavement should be dust proof. so that traffic safety is not impaired by reducing visibility. So what happens if this pavement is not dustproof due to the moving loads? So these suspended particle, dust particles will be suspended in the air, so thereby reducing the visibility. But that should not be the case. So then impervious surface, so that subgrade soil is well protected. The pavement should be impervious, that means it should not allow the water to percolate through it, so thereby thereby protecting the lower layers. The long design life with low maintenance cost. As far as possible, the pavement should have a higher design life with least maintenance cost. So here you can see this we will discuss on equal and single wheel load. So this is how the load is transferred to the lower layers. This is how the load is transferred to the lower layers. In case of flexible pavement, as I said, a grain to grain transfer will occur in case of flexible pavement. Here you can see, but here the stress is applied to the lower layers in the form of slab action or uniformly distributed load. Here you can see. So then, types of flexible pavement. So the flexible pavements are further classified as three types. One is conventional layered flexible pavement. The second one is full depth asphalt pavement. So then third one is contained rock asphalt mat. First one is conventional. First one is conventional flexible pavement. So these are layered system with high quality expansive materials are placed on top, whereas where stresses are high, and low quality or cheap materials are placed in the lower layers where the stress coming is likely to be very less. So then second one, full depth asphalt pavement are constructed by placing bituminous layer directly over the soil subgrade. This is more suitable when there is high traffic and local materials are not available. So that means even this base course or sub base course will also be made of these asphalt layers itself, such as SDBC or that is semi dense bituminous macadam. So like that, the pavements, the lower layer also made of bituminous layers. Then third one, contained rock asphalt mats, so are constructed by placing dense or open graded aggregates layers in between two asphalt layers. That means these aggregates are sandwiched between two asphalt or bituminous layers, that is contained rock asphalt mats. So here you can see, this is a typical cross section of flexible pavement subgrade. First one, it might be existing subgrade or natural subgrade, but also there will be one more compacted subgrade will be there. Then sub base course, then base course and surface course. Okay, so a cross section of rigid pavement, if you can see, subgrade existing soil, this sub base course only if needed. You can also skip this one. Then base course, it has to be non-erosive. Usually we'll go with DLC, dry lean concrete. So then concrete slab, that is lost surface course. Okay, so this is a typical cross section with different layers of flexible pavement. So compacted subgrade, usual thickness is also shown here. So then sub base course. So then we will be having a base course. So then on base course we'll have a prime coat, then binder course. On binder course we'll have a tack coat, then surface course. On the after surface course we usually have a seal coat. We'll see what exactly they are. So here you can see grain to grain transfer. Here you can see, so once the load is applied, so this aggregate will receive this load, then from this the load is being transferred to this and this aggregate. So now from this, these three aggregates are in contact, the load is being transferred. That means each aggregate acts as a grain. So now grain to grain transfer will take place in case of flexible pavement. So we'll see what exactly are these layers, typical layers of a flexible pavement. So first one is seal coat. So it will be usually provided above the surface course. A seal coat is a thin surface treatment used to waterproof the surface and to provide skid resistance and to seal the surfacing against ingress of water. That means it will make the surface course waterproof, and also it will provide sufficient friction to provide skid resistance. Then the second one is tack coat, usually provided on binder course. Okay, so it will be provided between binder course and surface course. Tack coat is a very light, So tack coat is a very light application of asphalt, usually asphalt emulsion that we discussed in the bitumen emulsion in the previous video, diluted with water. It provides proper binding between two layers of binder course and surface course. So it is generally applied on impervious surface. Then prime coat, this is usually provided between base course and the binder course. Prime coat is an application of low viscous liquid bituminous material over existing porous or absorbent pavement surface like waterbound macadam. That means base course. So prime objective is to plug the capillary voids of the porous surface and to bond the loose materials on the existing surface like granular bases on which binder course binder layer is placed. So it provides bonding between two layers. So here you can see this is a prime coat usually provided on a binder course. So this is a tack coat usually provided, a seal coat usually provided on surface course. Okay, so here you can see, so this is quite porous which seems to allow the water. In order to seal off this pores, so we provide a seal coat, thereby making it waterproof. That means it will not allow the water to percolate through the pavement layers. So then surface course, the topmost layer. Surface course is a layer directly in contact with the traffic loads and generally contains superior quality materials. So if you take aggregates, if you take bitumen, the quality of these materials will be very high as it is in direct contact with the wheel loads. So they are usually constructed with dense graded asphalt concrete, AC or BC, bituminous concrete. So it provides characteristics such as friction. The function of this surface course is it provides characteristics such as friction, smoothness, drainage, etc. Drainage means a camber will be provided, the water coming on the pavement layers will be drained off to the side drains that we discussed in the highway drainage. So it acts as a drainage also. It also prevents the entrance of excessive quantities of surface water into underlying base, subbase and subgrade. Obviously, as I said, it is made waterproof by providing a seal coat, thereby preventing the water percolation. So it provides smooth and skid resistant riding surface. It is also one of the function. It must be waterproof to protect the entire base subgrade from weakening effect of water. So then we have binder course. It will be provided just below the surface course. So this layer provides the bulk of the asphalt concrete structure. Okay, so its chief or main purpose is to distribute load to the base course. The load is distributed to the base course with the help of this binder course. The binder course generally consists of aggregates having less asphalt and does not require quality as high as surface course. So replacing a part of the surface course by binder course results in more economical design. So then we have base course. The base course is the layer of material immediately beneath the surface of the binder course, and it provides additional load distribution and contributes to the subsurface drainage. It may be composed of crushed stone and other untreated or stabilized materials. So then subbase course. The subbase course is the layer of material beneath the base course, and the primary function are to provide structural support, improve the drainage. It acts as a drainage layer. So it may be waterbound macadam or wet mix macadam. The subbase course is not always needed or used. For example, a pavement constructed over a high quality. So then subgrade. Okay, the top soil or subgrade is a layer of natural soil prepared to receive the stresses from the layers above. So ultimately, whatever the types of layers you provide, okay. So ultimately, these the loads on these layers need to be distributed to the soil. Okay. So this subgrade will aid in that matter. So it is essential that at no time soil subgrade is overstressed. So the, for the same reason, we provide these protective layers on this. It might be subbase course, it might be base course, it might be binder course or surface course. So all these will help in keeping the subgrade under protection. So it should be compacted to the desirable density. So types of rigid pavement, there are three to four types of rigid pavements are there. So one is jointed plain concrete pavement, then jointed reinforced concrete pavement, so continuous reinforced concrete pavement, so pre-stressed concrete pavement. We shall see what exactly they are. Jointed concrete pavement constructed with closely spaced contraction joints. Usually the joint spacing will be between 5 to 10 meter. So you would have seen on concrete roads we'll be having panels, panel like structures. So those panels are formed in order to provide a joints. So these joints are provided for expansion and contraction, or even to release the temperature stresses. Okay. So dowel bars or aggregate interlocks are normally used to load transfer across the joints. They normally has a joint spacing, as I said, 5 to 10 meter. So then second one is jointed reinforced concrete pavement. So reinforcements do not improve the structural capacity. Okay. So whatever the steel we are providing in the concrete pavements, so they will not aid in any structural improvement, structural capacity, improvement of structural capacity, but they can drastically increase the joint spacing. Okay. So joint spacing can be increased by providing this steel reinforcement. So from 10 to 30 meter. So dual bars are required to load transfer, usual requirements. Help to keep the slab together even after cracks. Then continuous reinforced concrete pavements. So this the steel will be running, this reinforcement will be running all across the length of the road. So thereby totally reducing the number of joints, or complete elimination of joints can be achieved. Okay. So here you can see these are the dual bars. So this is a slab like structure. One more panel will come here. So this is a longitudinal joint. So here contraction or expansion joint will come. So these dual bars will help to keep the both the slabs in together. Okay, the load transfer between the slabs takes place with the help of dual bars. Here you can see these are the joints. So now you can see this is a longitudinal joint. This is a transverse joints or contraction or expansion joints. So by providing the reinforcement, you can actually increase the spacing of these joints. So here is a cross section, you can see the dual bars provided. So longitudinal joints, transverse joint. So granular material, that is GSB, you can see here. So with that, we shall conclude this video lecture. So now, as I said, for your syllabus in the pavement design, only determination of equivalent single wheel load by graphical method is there. So for that, I shall upload the video soon after this video is uploaded. So please go through that video also. With that, three modules, third module is completed. So hope you have understood. If you have any queries, please leave your questions in the comment section. So thank you so much.